a teacher, an undersecretary general at the United Nations, a university professor, one of eight kids growing up in Saskatchewan. Elizabeth Dowdeswell was somewhat of an unknown entity when she was appointed Lieutenant Governor of Ontario. So joining us now for more on her mandate for the province during her tenure, we welcome Elizabeth Dowdeswell, the 29th Lieutenant Governor of Ontario and just the third woman to have the job. And it's great to meet you.
Thank you very much.
Although you did remind me in the control room ahead of time, we've kind of bumped into each other.
We have indeed. One of those little community places.
Those little restaurants around town where apparently we bumped into each other. But I think a lot of people don't know you, so do you mind if we just find out a little bit more about you for starters here?
Certainly.
You're not from here, right? You're from Saskatchewan?
I've been in Ontario more than half my life now, but born in Northern Ireland in Belfast, emigrated to Saskatchewan and lived in small town Saskatchewan. Did my basic education there and taught and then worked for the provincial government. My first experience in the public service.
How old were you when you left Ireland?
Four.
4 years old and then came here. Okay. So are you a Saskatchewan Rough Riders football fan?
Absolutely.
You are. See, now, if I were in charge of the vetting process, you'd have been off the list right away. I don't know how that happened.
Well, you know why I am, though. It's because I'm the eldest of eight, and my father used to make a practice of taking me to the Labor Day game, the traditional Labor Day game. Not my brothers, but he took me.
Good for him.
So it was a very special bonding experience.
That's lovely. And you're still a football fan?
Absolutely.
You're going to have to pick three other teams now.
I'm going to have to not pick teams, probably.
right, exactly. How did you move from high school teacher to high-ranking civil servant?
Serendipity. Just a series of interesting opportunities all the way along. I was teaching at the university, got a call to see if I would come and work for the Department of Education to write curricula, teach teachers, and do myself out of a job, and which I did. Did some federal provincial work and found myself one of the young and one of two female deputy ministers at the time. Hmm. Working in the field of culture.
And how'd you end up at the UN?
That was after experiencing work with the federal government in a range of fields, ending up in environment and being the head of the Canadian Weather Service at the time that climate change was emerging. And I had a lot of dealings with the World Meteorological Organization. Some developing countries came to our Department of Foreign Affairs and said, would you be interested in putting her name forward? And so they did, and the rest is history.
And there you go. You've had quite an eclectic background. I guess you didn't quite map it out this way, I'm guessing.
No, you can only understand it in retrospect.
Gotcha. How do you get to be Lieutenant Governor?
That I don't know either.
Well, do you apply for the job?
You get a phone call from the Viceregal Search Committee that says you're on a list. Is there any reason you shouldn't be on the list? And I said, well, I'm very honored. It certainly wasn't something on my radar screen. And months later, I got a call to speak with the Prime Minister, which I did, and was appointed shortly thereafter.
A lot of people don't know that. Even though you are obviously in the government of in the Parliament of Ontario, mm-hmm. in that viceregal tradition, the PM appointed you.
Absolutely.
And how does he do that? He calls you up and he says, Liz?
He said, would you come in and meet with me, which I did, and mm-hmm. we talked about my experience, and then he said, I'd like you to take on this job.
Did you know him?
No.
Never met him before?
Never met him.
You Conservative Party member or ever have been?
Apolitical.
Huh. Okay. Most lieutenant governors, I think, like to champion some issue of some significance during the course of their tenure, and of course, David Onley had the rights of the disabled, and James Bartleman before him had Aboriginal issues close to his heart. Have you decided?
No.
How come?
Because much of what I've done has been influenced profoundly by listening to people. I've worked on some very significant and very complex public policy issues, and I've always been reminded that I don't have a monopoly on good advice. That it's really very helpful to listen to what citizens have to say. Also in this case, I just have an interest in so many things. Hmm. But I want to hear what really resonates with Ontarians. And so it will help narrow the field, narrow the scope. And I don't intend for this listening period to go on for a long time, but I want to give myself at least until Christmas, maybe 6 months, to have an opportunity to see what really matters to people. That being said, I set a framework of challenges and a broad scope within which those choices would be made.
How will they inform you of what they think you ought to be considering?
Well, you know, the schedule is very full already of attending all kinds of things, from meetings with the OPP to a conference on technology to WE Day, for example, meeting with young people. There are lots of built-in opportunities to hear from people, but as well, I hope to be able to pull together some very diverse groups of people to have some conversations about what do they think about Ontario's role in the world, which is one of the things I'm interested in.
More on that in a sec. Did you know Premier Kathleen Wynne before you got the job?
No, we had met briefly years ago when I was actually consulting and doing a piece of work for the Toronto District School Board. And at that time she was on the school board, but it was a very acquaintance in passing, shall we say.
Do you feel you need to sort of bounce off her whatever issue you eventually decide upon?
Not in any formal sense. I think I have a fairly good sense of what's of interest and importance to the government. But my job is really transcends politics. It's really to take a look at what almost a mirror of how citizens are reflected in terms of what is of interest and importance to them. And my job is to actually provide opportunities for those conversations to take place.
Do you know what your, I mean, technical constitutional role is already?
I am learning, but certainly some of it is very obvious. The signing of orders in council, for example, passing, giving royal assent to bills. There is a lot of work that goes on behind the scenes. Every week after cabinet meets, there are documents to be signed. And of course, technically, the job is to ensure that that there is a smooth transitions in governance.
Mm-hmm. Let's just talk about that Ontario in the world idea that you did talk about in your installation speech, which was a great day, incidentally. No, that was a cool day, wasn't it?
It was great. You know, there are many moments that are humbling, and certainly that one was a very emotional one for me. Family and friends, it was a very joyous occasion. But you know, as I was out after the event was over, the inside event, and I was out reviewing the honor guard, and standing on the dais while O Canada was being played, beautiful blue sky, wonderful surroundings, and you just have to stand taller. when you work internationally, you have the opportunity to see your own country from a distance, from a different perspective. And we are so rich in this country in every sense. Our natural resources, of course, our basic respect for one another, the opportunities that we have, particularly here in Ontario. And somehow just standing there thought, how wonderful is this? It's a wonderful opportunity to celebrate who we are, but it's also a wonderful opportunity to say, we can be ambitious, we can be bold, and although people don't use the vision word much anymore, we can have a vision of what this society can really be like. And that has two parts. It's what we can contribute to the world, but it's also what we can learn from the world, because we are so interconnected.
I'm going to let a little cat out of the bag here, which is that when you were reviewing the honor guard, I saw one of the security guards at Queen's Park, and I said, can you let me sneak out there and snap a shot? So if you go onto our website, everybody, theagenda.tvo.org, you will find a shot that I snapped of you and the Premier and everybody else there from behind you doing the honor guard review, along with a number of other pictures from opening day, as it were, for
Wonderful.
You. But I want to, again, this Ontario in the world, I could be wrong about this, but my sense is that Ontarians, being the modest Canadians that we are, tend not to think that we have this gift that we have to bring to the world. Are you saying we got to get over that?
I think that we have some of the best scientists, artists, educators, business people, and I think they have so much to contribute to the world. And some of it, some sectors do, and we just don't hear about it. We don't know about it. And part of our job at the Office of the Lieutenant Governor is to celebrate who we are as a people and to make us proud, to share that. I find that's just a wonderful privilege that I have to be able to seek out those people and make known what they're capable of. We have amazing Canadians and many Ontarians working around the world and contributing in all kinds of ways. But it's also important that we learn from the rest of the world, because we, with the pace of technological change, the blurring of boundaries, the intense social media uptake, we really are citizens of the rest of the world, and we can't afford to turn inward.
What do we need to
whether
learn
it's
from
for
those?
Our economic development, whether it's for security questions, all of that, we need to have an understanding of how the world functions if we're going to function effectively.
Dalton McGuinty used to say that when he traveled the world, people would ask him, why don't we read anything in the newspapers about massive demonstrations in the streets? I mean, how do all your ethnic groups seem to get along so well? And I mean, you've been all over the world. Do you run into that kind of question? And if you do, what's the answer?
Well, I'm not sure I have a black and white answer, but what I would say is that I think Canadians and Ontarians have tried to create a different kind of society that is more inclusive, that does think about issues of social justice, that tries to address issues of poverty. And we do some of it well, and some of it we could improve upon. But I think we really need to be vigilant. I think that to many people, the world's a scary place these days. And it affects us not only in terms of our own security, but it also affects us in terms of economic opportunity.
Have you had a chance to talk to your predecessor, David Onley?
I have indeed.
What advice did he give you?
He told me to be myself. He did such wonderful work on the issue of disability. He also told me to remember to take care of myself, to make sure that I got a day off on occasion, because he and his wife, of course, worked so diligently. But he thought it was a magical place and just loved every minute of it.
One of the things, of course, he did was continue some of the work of his predecessor. Have you thought about whether you will want to continue some of the work of your predecessor?
I have indeed. I've gone back and looked at not just my immediate predecessor, but several. And certainly if I look at work on citizenship, on volunteerism, on women and girls, on Aboriginal literacy, on disability, all of those are important things, and I hope to be able to continue to give attention to all of those. I think there still needs to be room for new themes for new times, and so I think one can do both.
Let's finish up on this. You have referred in your speeches to the world facing three problems: inclusive prosperity, environmental sustainability, social cohesion. Why those three things?
Because for me, those three things are really what define sustainable development. A phrase that's known around the world, but it has come into disrepair, shall we say, because people throw around the adjective sustainable before everything. And I think what the original view of sustainable development meant is what I'm trying to get at, which is it's no good just to develop economically. It's no good just to focus on environment or just to focus on social cohesion and social development. It's really how do we make them all come together? Because we get into trouble when we in fact think of them only as silos. When we develop a wonderful economic opportunity in a small town, don't think about what it does to the environment. Don't think about what it does to the people who live there or what's required. we don't know very well how to think in an integrative way. And so I think finding a theme that actually illustrates how they can all come together is important. And more importantly than that, those are all issues that every country in the world is facing. Mm-hmm. We're not alone. So Ontario can, in fact, provide good lessons, but it can also learn from many other countries on those three challenges.
First time somebody called you Your Honor, what did you do?
I didn't answer. It's really quite funny. I was after the initial media scrum, I was going to another board meeting, and I was actually in the board meeting, and the chair was trying to get my attention, and he kept saying, Your Honor, and I wasn't answering because it was so new at that point.
You're going to hear it a lot more over the next 5 years.
Well, I hope to hear from a lot of people. I intend to try and cover a lot of this province in those 5 years.
And we wish you very well with your responsibilities over the next 5 years plus, because you never know. I think David Onley, by the time they were done, it was almost 7 years. So. He was a little harder to replace than I guess they thought. We wish you well. Thank you so much for visiting us at TVO today, Your Honor.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.